webinar is now live. Okay, we generally start about 5 after. All right, so. Can you unmask Alice for a moment?
Yes, I can do that.
Let him contribute to our conversation. He is. You are muted. No, you're not.
I'm muted, but I can't see. I'm on my wrong Zoom. I'm on my private Zoom. Let's see where I.
You're muted.
Well, this is an MIT thing, is to shut up any people from Berkeley. Let me shut them up.
We do our best.
Shut up their faces. Jesus, Griffin, you look good for an old man. Holy moly. Good to see you, buddy. It's been a long, long time. I've been in real crap town. I'm just finally coming out of it.
Right. No, I know.
Hey, Art, nice to see you. Welcome.
Thank you.
I'm finally getting back to Bob. I'm finally getting back to my full 50% capacity. My colleague said, "Alex, stop at 20%, please." Apparently, I'm a little too intense at 50 already. Mm-hmm. I've told Ashok. I don't know if Ashok gets these invitations, but he's now joined the faculty at Berkeley. He's mostly, of course, from the, you know, the hyperpolarization and the quantum information community. But he should be in on the NMR community. Bob, so if you could add him, or Kong, if you could add him to the list, that's Ashok Ajoy.
Yep, I think he was on my list, but I could do that.
If not, add him and see. I've told him he should start to
get
the NMR community. He's you know, he did PhD originally with Anil Kumar, so he did NMR, but now he's mostly with the Harvard crowd and the guys doing optics mostly and quantum computing and. But I think he should, and he was at MIT with Paola Capellaro.
Yeah, I've talked to him. So
amazing, very brilliant guy. And it's good to have him just, not on the panel, but just to have him invited so that he can.
Oh, well, he gave a talk a few months ago.
Right? Oh, terrific. All right, so he knows about it. I just wrote him, I didn't see because I haven't seen him around.
He was on the program a month.
As I said, Ashok, you should get back into the MR community. So there's some good stuff going on that you need to know about, and you can bring. I mean, I've noticed even you've got guys like Jalesko and I don't know if Michalukin himself, but guys like Jalesko and guys working in the area that I'm pursuing now with the single molecule NMR and so on. You've got that part of the NMR community, well, at least in Israel. Lucio has them connected.
Yeah,
I don't think they don't come to these. They don't know NMR, those guys. but a shop does. Ron Walsworth does, I think. Yep. Art, it's been a long time. Wow.
Lucio says, "Good art."
Lucio's there. Who said? Bill Gilbert says to me, I talked to him yesterday. He says, somebody, I'm talking to somebody, if I mentioned your name, he says, the guy says, Alex Pines is dead. And Bill said, are you out of your mind? He's completely alive. The guy says, no, I heard through the grapevine that he's dead. And Bill said, there is no way that Alex Pines would die without telling me. The old, if you die on me, I'll kill you.
Good morning, Lucio. Or good evening.
Good morning. Good morning. I don't know if, yeah, I think you can hear me.
So
evening, good to see you, Alex.
6 o'clock in the evening.
Good evening. Yeah. I didn't know that you were also talking today. I thought that only I was going to listen to art, but it's good to see you.
You're only going to listen to art, and I'm not talking. I'll give a talk. Now I'm feeling better. I'll finally start to, and I'll give a couple of talks on new stuff. And so maybe, Bob, I could do a kind of tutorial type thing on some really fundamental, maybe topology in NMR, things like that, which are slightly offbeat, but very good theoretical subjects for, I think it could be fun. It'd be fun for the students, yeah.
Okay, it's 10:05, so Con, why don't you get the ball rolling?
I mean, Alex, if you would like to do a tutorial thing, we can get you connected. I know the people who's doing that. Anyway, seeing we should not waste any more time. I mean, I would say good morning, good afternoon, good evening, to whoever is joining our Zoom meeting today again. And I would probably do a very quick introduction, or just for people who are joining our Zoom meeting for the first time. Feel free to sign up to our mailing list. And then if you're interested in looking at the past recordings, they are all available on our website. And also for all the Q&A, all the questions asked in the past sessions, I downloaded them and uploaded to the Dropbox folder, which you can track very quickly. And then I should also apply just one thing. I mean, two weeks ago, I announced the wrong names for the speaker session today. So I apply just for that. So today we'll be having two excellent speakers whom Bob will now introduce.
Okay. All right. So our first speaker this morning is a very well-known member of the magnetic resonance community, Art Palmer. Art was a graduate student at the University of North Carolina. He worked with Nancy Thompson, I believe, and did fluorescence spectroscopy. And then I guess he decided that fluorescence spectra were way too broad to learn too much from. So he decided then to do a postdoc in Peter Wright's lab at Scripps. And while he was there, he got involved with some other colleagues, and they wrote a book on protein NMR spectroscopy, which is a fundamental textbook these days that a lot of people read. I think it's in the third or maybe even the fourth edition. And today, Art is going to tell us about some new recherche aspects of relaxation theory that he's been working on. He's not clear, he says he's not clear if this will ever be publishable, but it's nevertheless very interesting. Art, the floor is yours, okay?
Thank you, Kong and Bob, for the invitation. This has really been a spectacular series, and I'm delighted to participate. As a solution NMR spectroscopist crashing a solid state NMR series, I thought what I should talk to you about today is statistics. And as I'll acknowledge at the end, this is really a project driven by a graduate student in the lab, Tim Crawley, and I'm merely the conduit for his ideas today. So the data that we'll use is for a small protein domain that we've studied over the years, all the way back in 1999. This is the DNA binding domain of a yeast protein called GCN4. It's involved in the control of gene transcription. And I'm not going to tell you anything about the biology today. You can see a crystal structure from Tom Ellenberger of the complex with DNA. the BZIP domain has two regions. There's a classical leucine zipper coiled coil shown in red. Under our conditions, I'm only going to tell you today about the apoprotein, no DNA, but under our solution conditions, the coiled coil is always formed. Then in blue shows what's called the basic region, because it contains a large number of arginines and lysines that interact with DNA. And you can see in the crystal structure, these form helices that insert into the major groove of the DNA. In the APO state, it had been known long before we did any work on the system that the basic region was partially disordered in the absence of DNA. And what's shown in the bottom image is just a representation of kind of the amplitude of the disorder in the basic region as you move towards the N-terminus from the coiled coil. So this will be the protein of interest, but as I said, it's really going to be a talk about the statistics of data analysis. Now, the data that we'll use was acquired by a postdoc in the lab a couple of years ago, Michelle Gill, and her analysis is published here in the reference at the bottom of the screen. She recorded N15 backbone relaxation data at four static magnetic fields, 600, 700, 800, and 900 megahertz, and then used the usual reduced spectral density mapping method to convert the relaxation rates into spectral density values, J of zero, J at the nitrogen Larmor frequency, and J at 0.7 times the proton Larmor frequency. And if you're not familiar with the reduced spectral density mapping method developed by Dennis Torsha and co-workers many years ago, this 0.87 just comes from averaging the zero, double, and single quantum spectral densities out at the out near the hydrogen Larmor frequency. In any event, the data or the analysis that I'll talk about, we've taken the four J0 values. Obviously, we get J0 measured at each of the four fields, and we've calculated, as shown in plot A, a weighted mean value of J0. That turns out to just help stabilize matters. So these are the data that we want to analyze. And the usual analysis in solution NMR is to apply the so-called model-free formalism that originated with Lipari and Szabo in the 80s. It's similar to the two-step approach of Halle and Wenstrom developed about the same time. But of course, there's alternative approaches as well in the literature, but I'm just going to talk about the model-free approach. Now, the basic problem I want to talk about today is model selection. In the usual approach that we and others take, one formulates a number of different model-free spectral density functions. There's the original function derived by Lipari and Szabo. There's a function derived by Klor and co-workers called the extended model-free formalism, but there's other variances you'll see on the next slide. So one has a family of model functions. One wants to fit to the data, and normally using an Occam's razor approach, one wants to identify the optimal model function with the fewest number of parameters that reproduces the data within the statistical error of the data. And model selection is normally performed using some kind of penalty function. It might be an F statistic, it might be AIC or BIC. In what I'll tell you about today, we use the small sample AIC, which is called AICC. But again, that's not particularly important to the talk. One could use other selection strategies. But the main point is some selection is performed to pick an optimal function that fits the data for a particular residue. And then uncertainties in the fitted parameters are typically determined by Monte Carlo simulations. What's shown on the left is a flow chart we published a long time ago showing kind of how we formulated the analysis back when we only had data at one static magnetic field. At the time we produced that flow chart, we thought we would have a better idea within a few months. It's taken 25 years to have a better idea. So here are the models we'll talk about today. So these models have order parameters, and I'll say order parameter when I really should say square of order parameter, but I'll try to save words. And internal correlation times, and then an overall correlation time. And again, for simplicity today, we'll just pretend that we have isotropic overall diffusion, but again, we can generalize if we need to. The fast and slow time scales are separated, again, empirically today, and you'll see why later, at 150 picoseconds. So motions faster than that, I'll call fast. Motions slower than that, I'll call slow. And these are very standard equations in the literature. So the conventional problem is, for a given residue in the protein, which one of these functions should we apply? And again, we'll use AICC today. So here are the results of this analysis. And again, this is the same kind of analysis we and others have been doing now for 25 years on backbone N15 data. So you can see the order parameter S squared, order parameter for motions on a fast time scale, order parameter for motions on a slow time scale, and then the corresponding time constants. In this particular case, we've assumed a fixed overall rotational correlation time for the disordered N-terminus and C-terminus. That correlation time has been fixed at the mean correlation time for the coiled coil. But again, that's not really important. We could make the overall tumbling times adjustable as well. So this is the conventional result. And you perhaps can sort of see the difficulty. If we look at panel C, the order parameter on fast time scale, you can see that there's a lot of scatter, say in the residue shown in pink and green in particular. And if you look at panel D, the time scale for the fast motions, you can sort of see what happens. In many cases, the model was chosen in which the fast time scale motion was set to zero, too fast to be characterized by the data. But for other residues, a time constant of around 50 picoseconds was identified. Those differences in the models propagate back to the order parameter and cause some of those fluctuations in the order parameter. At the same time, this difference in model selection, you can see, also perturbs the slow time scale results. And if you compare D in panel D and F, you can see that when there's a 50 picosecond fast time scale fit to the data, it has an effect of altering the slow time scale, the apparent slow time scale dynamics. So these effects are coupled, and they're strongly affected by which model happened to be picked by AIC. And obviously, if we're trying to draw some chemical or biological conclusions, the scatter in the data caused by this model selection procedure makes it more difficult to identify what's really a biological or chemical trend. So this problem caused by model selection error is not new. And in fact, already back in 2003 and subsequently, Edward D'Auvergne, when he was in Paul Gulli's group, wrote a series of very nice papers on the problems of fitting the model-free formalism. What's changed in the last decade really is the availability of relaxation data at more fields. And in particular, what I'm going to tell you about today really requires data at four fields. And in 2003, that wouldn't have been easy to acquire. The approach we're going to take is based on what in statistics is called the bootstrap. And first I'll tell you what the conventional bootstrap is. A conventional bootstrap would be an alternative method of estimating parameter standard deviations or uncertainties rather than doing Monte Carlo simulations. And the idea is we have a collection of data points, in this case, with four static magnetic fields. We have nine data points. We have four estimates of spectral density at 0.87 omega H, four estimates of the spectral density at the nitrogen Larmor frequency, and then we have an estimate of J0 that, again, we got by a weighted mean. So we're going to sample those data points in some way with replacement. So we always end up with a set of nine data points. And each of those samples is analyzed using the optimized model that we determined from the original data. And we do this a large number of times, typically a few hundred to a few thousand times, and then calculate the standard deviation of the model parameters. So if we had 1,000 bootstrap samples, we would end up determining 1,000 estimates for S squared, and then we would just calculate the standard deviation of those 1,000 values and call that the parameter estimate. So we would be reporting the parameter value determined from the original fit to the data, and only the parameter uncertainties come from the bootstrap. This has become, over the past decades, an incredibly powerful and widely used technique in statistics. But that's the conventional. Now, there's one problem with NMR data, particularly spectral density data, because first of all, we don't have that much of it. Nine data points sounds like a lot. It requires a lot of NMR time. But statistically, nine data points isn't very many. And secondly, the data points aren't identical. Obviously, J0 is very different from J omega H. So we solve this problem by making use of this table that I show here. So we have four values of each type of spectral density. We have four values of J0, four values of J omega N, and four values of J omega H. And we're going to select samples within each group of four, and we're going to do it using the vector shown as Pij. So the first entry where you see I equals one, Pij 1, 2, 3, 4, that says just take from one of the four blocks of data, data point number one, that would be the 600 megahertz data, data point number two, the 700, data point number three, the 800, and data set four, the 900. So that is just the original data if we apply that to J0, for example. Whereas I equals two says take the data at 600 megahertz twice, the data at 800 megahertz, and the data at 900 megahertz, leaving out the data at 700 megahertz. So what's shown in the table is all 19 possibilities, where at most any single field is represented no more than two times. We don't want to have very highly skewed samples. The idea behind bootstrapping is that the resampling is letting you get a sense of what the true distribution of the data is. And if we took a sample, for example, where all four replicates of J0 were the 600 megahertz data, that's not really providing information on the distribution. That's simply skewing the distribution. So after some experimentation, we decided that limiting this table to no more than two entries from any one field was a reasonable compromise. So there's 19 possibilities in this table. So we'll have 19 choices for the J0, 19 choices for J omega N, 19 choices for J 0.87 omega H. And then we concatenate those randomly, or not randomly, but by all possibilities, in order to generate a bootstrap sample. So that means we have 19 cubed possible bootstrap samples, which is 6,859. And we can then refit those samples to generate parameter estimates. In this table, the Y sub I's simply give the number of times each particular field is represented in the bootstrap sample, and we'll need these Y sub I's later on. So in some sense, this is the most important slide because this is what specializes the general bootstrapping approach to the problems we have in fitting NMR spectral density data. So if I just do this conventionally, I take the optimal models and then run this bootstrap, refit the bootstrap samples with the optimal model. Here are the results. The values of the data points are exactly the same as what you saw earlier. The only difference is the error bars now come from the bootstrap rather than from Monte Carlo simulations. So this is what one would do conventionally, and it's really just an alternative to doing Monte Carlo simulations. But what we want to do is get at the problem of model selection error. And in the statistics literature, this is called bootstrap aggregation or bagging. The statisticians like making names up for things just as much as NMR spectroscopists do. And the approach that we'll take comes from a paper by Efron, who's one of the giants in modern statistics, published 6 years ago. So in bootstrap aggregation, what we're going to do is for every one of the bootstrap samples, we're going to redetermine the optimal model. In the conventional bootstrap, the optimal model was determined once for the original data and not changed. But now every one of the 6,800 samples will have its own optimal model picked. So again, we generate the bootstrap sample with replacement. We analyze each sample and determine the optimal model by AICC. And then we're going to have the problem, of course, that some bootstrap samples will have an optimal model that, for example, maybe does not have a slow time scale parameter in the model. So for any model we pick that is missing some parameters, we set a missing order parameter to 1 and a missing internal correlation time to 0. That obviously says that motion isn't there. So now we can determine the mean parameter values by averaging over the bootstrap results, but now we're averaging both over what models were selected as well as the variation in the parameter within a given model. And that's what's different from the conventional model. So that part is simple. The difficulty now is what are the parameter uncertainties? So we want to know the values averaged over the model selection, but obviously we also want to know the uncertainties. And it turns out just calculating the standard deviation of the bootstrap deviation of the bootstrap distribution is a bad idea. And Efron worked out a procedure, and I'm not going to go through any of the theory. I'm just going to show you the results. So we can write our actual data here as Y bold-faced Y vector. These are our original spectral densities. Our optimal model fit to the original data is called mu here, or mu caret with the hat on top. Mu has, as you can see, 5 possible parameters, tau m, sf squared, ss squared, tau f, and tau s. And then in the notation that we'll use, the optimized value of the parameters is mu with the little caret on top. And that's determined by a model T sub M. So T sub M is the optimal model applied to the original data that gives us the optimal parameters. And then we do bootstrapping, and now the bootstrapping data is indicated with the asterisk. And now we have the parameters that came from the bootstrapping. And now each bootstrap sample I has its own model, T sub I. The model isn't fixed. And I'll indicate that then those parameters with the tilde rather than the caret. And then our reported value, as I said, is just the average of the bootstrap results. So mu tilde is what we would report as the parameter values rather than the data obtained from the original data. And then here's the procedure for calculating the uncertainties or the standard deviation of the parameters. Again, in the interest of time, I'm not going to belabor it. We calculate the covariance between essentially the bootstrap replicates and the measured parameters, and then form the sample, the standard deviation as basically the mean of all the covariances. And that's, so this is a recipe. And again, it's worked out in Efren's paper. Now, one thing we wonder, how does this all work? So here, the uncertainties then calculated by these procedures. The left-hand graph compares Monte Carlo to the conventional bootstrap. And you can see the errors are in about the same order of magnitude. They're uncorrelated with each other. This is some evidence that our bootstrapping procedure was reasonable. The middle panel compares the Monte Carlo results to this smooth bootstrap aggregation result. And the smooth bootstrap aggregation uncertainties tend to be a little larger, and that reflects the model uncertainty. And the rightmost panel just shows why it's a bad idea to use the naive standard deviation over the smooth data. It gives much larger uncertainties. Here's what it looks like in practice. Now the parameter values are from the smoothed estimate. The uncertainties are from the smoothed estimate. But it's probably better to compare them directly back with the conventional analysis. So if you look at the order parameters, for example, you can see the effect of the bootstrap aggregation has really smoothed out the variation you saw in the conventional analysis. It's very evident in panel C versus D. In panel C, you can see there's more smooth behavior. The little bumps we know from molecular dynamics simulations represent sites where there's higher probability of transient turns of helix forming in the basic region. So those bumps are real, and you can see they're much harder, much easier to discern in the smooth data. Similarly, here's the smooth versus conventional timescales. Now you can see we have uniformly in on the fast timescale a process in the range of 25 to 50 picoseconds. And more interestingly, on the slower timescale in the basic region, you see a very consistent process at about 1 nanosecond. In Michelle's original paper, when we had data that looked more like panel F, we speculated that this was probably representing some dynamic process with a fairly uniform correlation time. But of course, with this scatter, that was a bit of a guess, and it's much more believable looking at the data here. So that's really the main advance. I have a few slides to just show you why it works, but in the interest of time, I may skip over these. I'll just quickly click through them. But here's the main idea. For residue 11, for example, our selection criteria selected model 4 because that has the smallest AICC. But you can see model 5 was basically just slightly worse as a choice the difference is less than one unit. In the smoothing, in the bootstrap aggregation, the bootstrap samples generated about 24% of the time model 4 was optimal, and 76% of the time model 5 was optimal. So the smoothing averages over some of model 4, some of model 5. And again, that's shown here in the table. And if we look at histograms of the bootstrap samples, you can see what's happening. If we look here at the time scales, the pink color are fast motions, the blue color are the slow motions. The conventional analysis would have not included a separate time scale for fast motions. As a result, the time constant in the conventional analysis, shown as the orange bar, is skewed to the edge of the distribution of the slow time scales, because the conventional analysis had to somehow average over the information content in the data on both fast and slow time scales. But after the bootstrap smoothing, both of those time scales are taken into account. We can play this game with other residues and see much the same effect. And of course, in some cases, there's really only one motional model, and both the conventional and the smoothing pick it up. I think I'll just end with the conclusions. So model selection error has been known for a long time. The bootstrap aggregation smooths parameter values and uncertainties over the different models to account for model selection variability. We see the effect of this in GCN4, that's evident in increased uniformity of the parameter estimates. So the most important thing then is the use of bootstrap aggregation or bagging increases the likelihood that the parameter patterns that we see, or the variation in the model-free parameters, reflect real effects rather than just random variation coming from the model selection process. And then this, of course, is a general technique. I've talked about it in the context of analyzing relaxation data, but huge numbers of areas in NMR involve building models and fitting models to data. So this approach is likely to be more useful in these other areas as well. So as I said, this work was done by Tim Crawley, a graduate student in the group. We're hoping this will be submitted next week. If you like math, Tim has a paper in preprint form at Magnetic Resonance on a new way of calculating the performance of shape pulses. And much of this work is done at the Center on Macromolecular Dynamics by NMR Spectroscopy, which is a P41 National Center within the New York Structural Biology Center. It's open for everybody. Just go to the website and contact us if you're interested in using any of the technology at the center. With that, I thank you for the invitation.
Okay.
All right. Bob, you want to do it?
Go ahead, Tom.
Thank you, Art, for showing us a very interesting talk where you show using bootstrap method to yield smaller parameters that might account for variabilities based on model selections. And I'm just looking at a question, and of course, Alex also raised his hand. Alex, you want to go first? You want to ask a question? Or was this? Yeah,
I'm unmuted here, okay. Yeah, Art, a great lecture. Very naive question, which you'll permit me, obviously, a stupid question. At the very beginning, you showed a model of the motion, and you fitted to long correlation times. And you said, when I fitted to a picosecond time, things changed in the longer correlation times, which implies a correlation. You then went back to that slide later with a uniform spectral density. Now, my question is there in fact a physical implication from that regarding correlation between the short and the long correlation times? If so, what is the physical picture of that?
Mm-hmm. So some of the apparent correlation in the conventional analysis is just caused by the model selection. It's not real. in the more smooth data, we don't have such strong information about correlations between the motions, mostly because the simulations that we've done so far aren't really long enough to capture the slower process as well. It's quite clear in the simulations that you have this was work done by Paul Robustelli, I should say, who's now an assistant professor at Dartmouth. On the faster time scale, those little bumps in the profile for the order parameters are clearly transient formation and breaking of helical turns. And when the turn forms, the order parameter is higher. The uniformity of the slow time scale process possibly suggests a correlated swinging of the basic region arms. And of course, there's been a lot of interest in the literature as to whether these disordered regions are moving around in what's called fly casting, looking for their targets. So it's certainly kind of an intriguing hypothesis that the uniformity of the slow time scale motion on the kind of 1 nanosecond time scale might reflect that. But that's really just a speculation at this point. We don't really have any hard NMR or simulation data that would really answer that question.
Thank you. Just a brief aside, Moise, Eric, issue that it's a real fundamental question. For the fast rotating group on a slow rotating molecule, you get additional effects which actually lead to big surprises and some mistakes in the literature, because you get half integer quantum numbers for the rotation. It looks like a pseudo rotation on this fast rotating group. And so that changes the actually positions of spectral densities and so on. But again, we can talk about that separately, but there's a topological issue when you have a fast group on a slow group. It's like the old, you know, when you turn your body and turn a bottle of wine in your hand, you get these 360 degree and you get 720, making it look like a spinner rather than a normal spin behavior. So just, we can talk about that separately, but that's why I was curious about any correlations that you saw. Anyway, thanks for your answer. Terrific talk.
So our first paper, as you saw, was 1999, done by one of my first postdocs, Clay Bracken. So he and I are now on a 20-year argument as to whether the tail wags the dog or the dog wags the tail. And that relates to your comments, I think.
All right, so thank you for your question, Alex. So next, let's move to the next question. So from Walt Masevsky, our good friend at MIT, what are the possibilities to use field cycling or shuttling experiment to sample the spectral density over a much larger range of frequencies? Right.
So as you see on the slide I have up, you'll see in green that NYSBC has installed a field cycle shuttle, and Shabani Bhattacharya, who's one of the staff scientists there, has acquired a full set of field cycling data on GCN4, and we're in process of analyzing that to just get exactly at the question you ask, Walt. And perhaps in another year, Bob will have me back and I can tell you what we've learned from that. But certainly following what Fabian Farage has been doing, we're very excited to get the lower field regime.
All right, I guess this is also somehow related to Jeffrey's question, because he asked you, in addition to the force like 3 FUs, would it help to add the relaxation rates at, like, let's say 0.33 Tesla? So we guess we'll know in a year.
Exactly. That's why we want to do it. We do have some models for spectral density that we've worked on with Fabian Farage that can't be distinguished if you only have high field data. And only by having low field data could you distinguish these different motional models. So it's absolutely essential question.
Okay, so we have next question from Jeff Reimer. He seems to recall that NOE do not include the spectral density J of 0. So wouldn't measuring those constraints some of the model J's and Tau's?
So the N15 NOE doesn't contain J0, and it's that NOE that really provides information on the spectral density out at the proton Larmor frequencies. Now, the question of how one might take proton-proton NOEs into account with the nitrogen data or carbon relaxation data is really an effort that's been driven by Roland Reek's group. And we're also interested in those approaches, but we really don't have data yet that we would be able to try to incorporate. But obviously, as I said, we're data limited. So the more data we get, hopefully the better.
All right. Thank you for your answers. And then like Alex raised his hand again. Maybe he wants to comment on
something. I wanted to follow up. You made a wonderful comment at the end. You said there's an argument between you and your long range 99, so 21 year collaboration. We've argued about whether the dog wags the tail, where's the dog. I have an opinion on that, which I'm going to state beforehand so you don't think I'm taking a side. After I hear which side you're on, I think that the dog wags the tail in this case. I can make a case for that. I'm curious, which side did you come up on between you and your collaborator?
Well, in the fact that in this particular analysis that I showed you, we fixed the rotational correlation time for the flexible region to match that of the coiled coil is an implicit assumption that the dog wags the tail. Now, one reason this becomes, I think, why we keep coming back to this model system is that we can at least approximately nail a diffusion tensor onto the coiled coil so that we're looking at dynamics in the basic region and the disordered region relative to that diffusion tensor. And we always hope that this helps us understand in a kind of intermediate sense the problems faced by Martin Blackledge and others who are doing these relaxation measurements in fully disordered proteins, IDPs, or Nick Fauci in phase separated states, you know, many, many other people I haven't mentioned, where they don't really have a diffusion tensor well-defined. So how do you interpret data in those cases versus how you interpret data for a globular protein? And then we always come back to GCN4 in the hope that it's kind of an intermediate state that might give us some insight on how we treat the more complicated problem where you don't have a really well-defined diffusion tensor.
Thank you. I'm happy to see that I'm basically on your side in your case, you fixed it, but with the dog wagging the tail. I think that's an interpretation that should be imposed on these in order to, even in cases where it's not known, the diffusion tensor. Thanks a lot, Art.
So Art, I mean, you've always confined yourself to solution, I suppose, for doing a sort of dilute solution kind of regime. But if you took a reasonably large protein, it would have to be larger than QCM4, but something, you know, 65 kilovolts or something, you put it in the magic angle rotor, you do spinning, you're going to centrifuge it out. Okay, so then you still have something approaching a solution, but you have also what I at one point called it behaves a little bit like a solid as well. So that would get rid of your overall correlation time.
Mm-hmm.
Time. Would that simplify your analysis? Would it help? I mean, have you thought about doing anything like that? So, I mean, you have lots of high frequency spinning equipment at SBC.
Well, as you know, there's now extremely exciting work being done on dynamics of proteins by solid state NMR. And again, a list of people longer than I could mention, Paul Shanda, Josef Lewandowski, many other people. I don't want to insult people by leaving them off the list. And in in the absence of tumbling, obviously, one of the problem, a great problem for us in solution is motion slower than tumbling are basically erased from the spectral density by overall tumbling. And we don't see them again until we get to kind of the chemical shift time scale and relaxation dispersion and CEST experiments start to become very powerful. In solids, of course, without that restriction from tumbling, you have a much wider window. On the other hand, you know, a certain amount of, let's say, the model free theory, et cetera, has the convenient fact that tumbling ensures that you're in kind of a fast limit in the Redfield sense. So just moving, as you know, people are finding out and working on, you know, just kind of naively moving over to solid state, the kind of theoretical approaches that we've used in solution isn't always the completely correct thing to do. So I think there's a lot of development going on, both experimentally and theoretically. And I'm not so sure that I have anything to add that those many investigators aren't already doing.
So Jeffrey has another question he just posed. Why don't you simply drop one of the four fields rather than repeat one of the four artificially? In your slide of 19 different.
Mm-hmm. So in the statistics literature, of course, these kind of leave one out or leave K out are quite powerful techniques as well. Sometimes in the statistics literature, the leave one out approach is called the jackknife. Again, statisticians like cute names too. The problem is that we don't generate as many samples that way. And we really need a large number of samples to have some hope of characterizing the distribution. So it's really just a practical limit. That's one reason why we need four fields. If we did this at three fields, we can only get slightly more than 300 samples by resampling. And that's probably not enough to really have the problem even approaching convergence. So it's really just a numbers game.
Okay, thanks.
And that has something to say.
So, all right. So let's move on to our second speaker today, Art.
I think Lyndon just raised his hand.
Oh, Lyndon. Okay.
Yeah. Would you like to ask your question, Lyndon?
Oh, sorry, that was a mistake.
Oh, okay, no problem.
But there is no dog. The dog is dead, I think.
Okay, you sure you don't want to ask a question, Lyndon?
Yeah, no, that was my only comment. The dog is dead.
Okay, all right. Okay, so the next.
My condolences, Lyndon. I'm really sorry to hear that. My dogs we work with are alive and well.
Yeah, I know, but you know, everything has to come to an end.
All right. Okay, so our second speaker today is Vlad Michaelis. And Vlad was a undergraduate at Manitoba, University of Manitoba in Canada. And he hung around there and did his PhD with Scott Croker's group. He came here as a postdoc and he did his best to turn my group, which is very biologically oriented, into a material science research group. He published a lot of papers on a lot of very interesting topics during that period. And then he left here a few years ago, I guess maybe about 5 years ago now, and he's now a tenured professor at the University of Alberta. And so today he'll tell us about the energy-related materials to the eye of solid state NMR.